really tired or what?
Ready to go for it, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, good luck out there.
You too. Thanks.
Alaska, in Eskimo language, means the Great Land. 1.5 million square kilometers of mountains, tundra, and ice from Canada to the Straits of Bering. The United States bought the territory from the Russian Tsar Alexander II about 100 years ago. A deal they have no reason to regret. The land is rich in forests, gold mines, oil fields, and possesses one of the world's richest fishing waters. Royal crab, salmon, and halibut are abundant, making fishing one of the state's main industries. Nonetheless, Alaska is not a particularly appealing territory to most people. The climate is harsh, the landscape rugged, and the building of roads and towns practically impossible. Difficult to survive in this vast region without a plane. Planes mounted on skis, floats, or wheels replace cars, supply trucks, and ambulances. Over the past few years, they have taken on a crucial role in herring fishing.
Yesterday,
final
for the gillnet catch?
No, roger. And the row percent is about 10 3/4, okay?
Thanks.
As with other natural resources, Alaska's fish supplies are not unlimited. The state government has recently put severe restrictions on fishing. Herring is the most tightly controlled. In each of 5 locations, herring fishing is permitted for 30 minutes per year. In the space of 30 minutes, 70 seaplanes, 125 boats, and 7,000 men capture hundreds of tons of herring.
They're 29 feet deep.
Okay, we're not gonna see them from the airplane.
No, no, you're not gonna see those from the airplane. They're gonna come to us here pretty quick. This biomass, this is the,
who
in the hell knows, 500 tons of fish there. Got another school over here at 11 o'clock. It's been moving this way also. Everything seems to be coming
moving
this
out
way.
Of the bay.
Yeah. We have our radio gear and we've got our so-called private channels that we think nobody else is listening to. But we own a scanner to scan other people, so I'm sure other people own a scanner to scan us. Well, there are no
what
secrets.
What happens after the fishery?
Well, we usually talk over, discuss the mistakes that we made, and or the mistakes we didn't make, hopefully. And this group of guys here is a real good group of fellows to work with. We usually don't scream at each other or call each other names or anything, and which happens in the fishery, that's for sure. But we've got a real good group here.
Oh, it's really nice out. The sun is shining.
Look at what I have in here. Jack and banana.
Dan and Lori belong to this small group of pilots who fish for a living. Their role is to spot the schools of fish from the sky and guide the boats towards them. Lori's the only woman pilot in a world dominated by men. She teams up with Bob, captain of the Lady Lynn, and one of the best fishermen in Alaska.
No, I'm looking wrong.
Here's Nuka Island.
Right, this is Moonlight Bay. The next to the last one on the right, there's a reef that goes across here. Mm-hmm. These fish go up and hit the reef, and then they come back into these bays and spawn. The last two bays on the right. Mm-hmm. And the one year we got 200 ton of 13.5% fish out of that Moonlight Bay.
So where's the ones where the young fish are?
Harris Bay.
Oh, right here.
Which is right in there.
What's the relationship between a fisherman and his pilot? Is it love and hate?
Love and hate, yeah. When you get the big set, you just really love them. And when you don't get the big set, you hate them.
How long have you been working with Laurie?
4 years. 3 or 4. Maybe 5.
And? You're still working with her?
Oh, yeah. She's here, isn't she?
Oh, no.
It's an interesting business.
The risky business.
It's risky. There's a lot of stories of airplanes setting boats around rocks and around kelp and.
Lori never does that.
You know, so.
The wrong way.
A lot of pilots.
Left, I mean right, I mean.
Never get their act together.
The department intends to proceed with a Persane Sacra opening today. This opening will include all waters of Zykov Bay and only the outer portion of Rocky Bay. The opening in Zykov Bay will be of longer duration than the Rocky Bay opening. The exact coordinates will be provided at least 1 hour prior to the opening.
The Alaska Department of Fish and Game decides exactly when and where the fishing will be permitted based on the maturity of the herring eggs. It's known for a fact that Japanese pay high prices for herring, not for the fish itself, but rather for its eggs, which they consider to be the finest caviar. The boats make their way towards Rocky Bay. Dan and Lori patrol the area to spot the schools of herring. Then they place themselves in a strategic position. The waiting begins. It can last for hours.
What are we doing down now?
Well, we're just gonna sit here and wait for a little while the...
Is there gonna be any fishing today?
Well, I think it's a distinct possibility here. We could go at 7 o'clock maybe, or 7:30, we got a 6:30 announcement, so I think it's a definite possibility we could go fishing today.
Fishing permits cost $200,000 per boat per year. The stakes are high and the competition tough. If the nets are full, the team makes a fortune, $5 million per boat. If not, they can lose their shirts. The countdown begins. Everyone is ready, attentive, waiting for the final announcement, which will set boats and planes in motion.
This is the Alaska Department of Fish and Game.
Roger.
And then there's another school on the outside of the island. 2 more schools on the outside of the island. 3, 4 more schools on the outside of the island. If you look to your right, just on the tip of the island, there's one just a beam on the outside of the island. And then there's 3 more past that.
Yeah, how big are they,
though?
They're
coming right in between now. So you should be cut it loose right there.
Cut it loose!
And open it up and let it come in that way.
Now just hold everything right there. Have the skiff tow easy and set here a minute.
Close your mouth.
As soon as the fishing is over, everyone moves on to the next location. There are only 5 openings each year in 5 different areas. The next one is scheduled for the Togiak area in southwest Alaska. The boats are already lifting anchor. They have a 100-mile stretch to cover. Pilots spend every spare minute on the maintenance of their planes, which are constantly exposed to harsh weather conditions. Togiak is known for its severe climate. Each year, the number of planes increases and the airspace allotted to each one diminishes. Gasoline is transported in barrels. Loading and unloading of the gas is one of the more tedious tasks.
How can you watch me do this?
How do you feel about the danger in this whole thing? I mean, do you feel it's a dangerous job and you're risking your life each time you go up there?
Yeah, I feel like it's very dangerous. I'm really opposed to these guys who are flying around with just one person in the airplane. You know, that part really scares me, and I don't like that. But when you get up there, and, you know, I depend on my observer a lot, and Michelle is really great. She's one of the best ones I've ever had. She just, you know, it's a hard job to do, because there's no glory in it, and you're just looking for other airplanes. It's probably pretty boring, but it's such an important job, and it's, you know, It really eases your mind to have somebody sitting there that can help you out.
Mainly to just be there as a second set of eyes to see traffic that the pilot can't while they're doing their job. I'm just constantly looking out every direction I can for other aircraft and warning Lori if it's looks like it's going to be an interference. Besides that, I just try and help her out with the, you know, general upkeep on the plane and keeping the windows clean and pump the floats and gas up and whatever she needs me to do. I'm kind of just her Girl Friday.
But you're a pilot too.
Yeah, I am a pilot.
So you can eventually take over?
Yeah, well, I'm hoping to fly in Alaska here one day.
Little Memphis Boogaloo, you can get out there and do the Memphis Underground.
In Alaska, where the law is every man for himself, pilots disagree on the crucial issue of observers.
You don't understand me. We just came.
Flying alone entails enormous risks, especially for the other pilots. Some pilots are adamant about having co-pilots or observers to avoid accidents. Others refuse. Dan and Lori are among those who fight for regulations requiring observers in each plane. Every year, one or two pilots are killed in accidents. Tom Parker, one of the most experienced pilots and a close friend of Dan and Lori, was this year's first casualty. On the day of the accident, he was flying alone.
Butterflies in my stomach, and I don't sleep very good.
Really?
Especially when the weather's like it is today. It's not too bad, but it'd be nice if it was clear blue skies.
How many boats do you have lined up today?
Well, three boats, but two of them are 20 hours out. So I'm hoping we don't fish. I got one boat here right now. Our tender's not here.
So. Think it's going to be pretty dangerous today, tomorrow?
Well, I don't know about tomorrow. I know that up right now that if they had an opening, I assume most of the fleet is up around Tongue Point. They got about 1,000-foot ceilings there, so it'll be dangerous.
How long have you been involved in fish spotting?
This is my 13th year.
What did you do this job for?
Pardon?
Why do you do this job? I mean, is it a way of life, or it's for the money, or?
Well, it gets a way of life. It kind of gets in your blood too, you know. But it's for the money. I mean, it's a job, and the way I say it probably it gets addicting. I mean, every springtime you start looking forward to it, you know, after the winter and everything. So. But I wish it was nice, clear blue skies.
A lot of company, Lori.
Yeah, I know. There's no other show in town, that's why.
Okay, you want me to try to make a tow haul then, coming south?
Yep, roger. The fish coming towards you, south, from north to south. Yeah, looks good, right? Yeah. There's fish coming towards you, little Joe. It's looking good, I think, in here on the beach.
Are they on the beach, Lori, or outside?
They're on the beach, but
east of 4 mile lengths off the beach. I'm just coming around again. It's hard for me to get, I can only get in for a short time and make it, and look, for a minute, and I can barely, shit.
Just above Togiak, planes are swarming around like bees. Boats gather the masses of herring into their nets as time runs out. State ranchers aboard their helicopters keep the boats under close surveillance. Legal fishing times are enforced to the split second. In the event of a violation, the penalty can range from a fine of $7,000 to the seizure of the fishing boat. The fishermen prefer abandoning their catch to breaking the law.
Didn't really good. I mean, pretty good. But, I almost hit somebody.
Really?
Yes, it was really close. I mean, Michelle said, look, and I went,
no, I said,
and
Lori! I screamed.
If she wouldn't have saw him, we would be dead. For sure. Absolute positive sure.
So that sums up the observer story.
Yes. Sort of.
Thank God for
case closed.
And quick reactions from top-notch pilots.
The fish spotters accept the high risks. After all, it's what allows them to open their windows each morning onto one of the few virgin territories left in the land. For Dan, Lori, Michelle, and Bob, high profits are not the only motivation. In Alaska, there is a certain feeling of fraternity. The quality of life is intensified by the high risks they take together, but also by the sense of purity and freedom.
Oh, in the winter time, it is so beautiful here. Those mountains are killer.
What's the matter, Tim?
Mom, they did another shirt for me. And have short arms, my arms are torn.